Well, hello there again, friends. Today is 5/17/2022, and today is the Odin Project Vlog Day 104. And today I went through module number 6, classes. And without further ado, let's just get started. So this is a nice discussion about the classes and the availability of that using that attribute in JavaScript. I'm going to go over the knowledge check at the end because there is a small exercise with this that I want to make sure that I have time to cover. So ideally, as I've always said, you guys should be following along and doing these readings on your own anyway. I just do this vlog style so that I can kind of track the progress, so to speak, for myself, just for documentation purposes. But there's three great articles here. And then there's an interesting article that kind of goes over the pros and cons for classes, and we'll go over that here now in the knowledge check, but it's kind of interesting. So let's see. I might do a little bit of control F with you guys on some of this stuff here, but we'll get through it together here. Describe the pros and cons of using classes in JavaScript. So right off the bat, it takes you out to that third article. And it's called "Is Class in ES6 the New Bad Part?" And essentially, sorry, I'm all over the place here. The pros and cons. All right. So basically, the whole article is really about the pros and cons. But basically, conceptually, the argument is there is no class in JavaScript. Objects are created without classes in JavaScript. So technically, by a class purist that's used to it using like Java, for instance, where you actually define your public and private classes and all that jazz. In JavaScript, in that world, there really isn't a class because objects are created without classes. You do it like either via prototype or through object constructors or factory functions. And all that can basically take care of the same thing without using class. So class as an argument on that part really isn't a thing in JavaScript. And this goes through a neat little article. I won't go into detail with it, talking about in the Java world how inheritance works with classes and how JavaScript works with the prototype. They're using an example of the prototype instance. And then two, bad for functional programming. It says in JS functions, our first class citizens, functional programming is all about using functions to their fullest extent. There's this notion called favor composition over inheritance in Java. And here we're doing the opposite JavaScript with the direction, because class notates favors inheritance over composition, which means that that in JavaScript we're favoring inheritance over anything else because it's an inheritance based relationship, whereas in the DNA model shown here, there's inheritance, but it's favoring composition through the delineation down from the inheritance. So that's that. Summary, it's a good part because class is something everyone learns and makes the syntax better and good. Is a good thing, at least for JavaScript. It's an optional feature, and there are other ways to create objects like factory functions, like I just mentioned. And three, using it for limited purposes is fine. It's a bad part because the concept of class doesn't exist in JavaScript. We just kind of talked about that briefly. Again, I'm highlighting this article. You should definitely read it on your own. Number two, concept of classes makes things brittle. Prototypes are better and very flexible. We've went over that before. And three, it guides people away from goodness and power of functional programming. And so that's that. Briefly discuss how JavaScript's object creation differs from a language like Ruby. Okay, so we go right back to the same article. I'm pretty sure we just discussed that basically. So basically, JavaScript's object creation is through the either the constructor or the factory function, or now we just learn class. And that differs because Java and Ruby, for instance, do the use the actual class attribute only, and it doesn't base it on prototypical inheritance. That's one of the main differences. There's some others, but for the brevity of the video, I won't explain all of them. You'll learn them when you read the articles. Explain the difference between using a class to define a constructor and other prototypical methods. So this takes out the MDM article, which is the second article. Difference between using a class to define. Excuse me. Okay, difference between using a class to define constructor and other prototype methods. Okay, so one way to define a class is using class declaration. So this is one way of doing it. Class rectangle, and then you have your constructor embedded inside of it. This article goes over all that here. You can use the class keyword with the name rectangle here. So we have a class called rectangle, and it has a constructor inside of it that does the very similar thing that we've used to doing with the object literal and the object constructor. And then you would call it with by the same that gives you a reference error because it's not using hoisting. So you would call it here's how you properly call it. Const square equals new rectangle 10 10, and so it's gonna call new rectangle. New is the keyword here for rectangle. It's gonna call the class and the constructors inside of it, so it's going to construct the height and the width 10 10, and you got a getter and a setter and a method. So that's essentially that. This is a meaty article. Don't skip it. I just don't want to spend time to cover it because I do want to get to exercise. I just want to cursory answer these questions. Explain what getters and setters are. So as I understand, a getter is something when you want to just return something. Like you're saying, hey, JavaScript, here's this, return my value. And then a setter is, hey, JavaScript, here's this. Now I want you to make this out of this. So I don't know if does this one have getter and setters on it. Okay, of course there's a getter. Is there a setter? Might be the other article. Yeah, it's not talking about getters and setters here. It's the first. This is the first article, the JavaScript info article. This one's really good, really beefy too. It's good stuff. There's a setter. So just like objects, literals, classes may include getters and setters, computed properties, etc. Here's an example for a user implemented using get set. So here it's using get name. So we're creating a variable called user, and it's inputting new user John. So we're going to invoke the user class here, and it's going to invoke the setter when inside the constructor with the name equals this dot name, and it's going to go down linearly to get name, return this underscore name, which, as you remember from previous reads, underscore is usually a nomenclature reserved for private variables. So we're going to return this dot name back out, and then it's going to set name, and it's going to do an if check. If value dot length is less than 4, alert name is too short, return, and that's your set. So here's a get where it's just returning the information, and a set is where it's evaluating and doing something. And so if you invoke that user, a new user with a blank string, you're going to get an alert saying name is too short, which is right here. Understand what computed names and class fields are. I don't remember that one, not going to lie. I spent the last couple days looking at this. See, off and on. So this one was from yesterday. Understand the computer names and class fields are. I think that's just talking about. Okay. Computer name. Here's an example of the computer method using brackets. Okay. Didn't spend a lot of time on this, or I breezed over it. But you can actually have bracket notation here with say plus hi, and this will alert hello. And so it's cool because what it'll do is it'll combine that as say hi, which so when you call new user, it's calling the class, and then it's invoking the say hi method, which in bracket notation will combine that. Say, you know, string say plus string hi is say hi in bracket notation. The computed name comes out to a method, so that's pretty cool. So that's basically how you do computed names and class fields. Class fields are things that are defined inside of your class. So this would be like example at name equals John, and that's a private variable called name that, as we learned before, wouldn't be available in of itself outside of the class. So you have to remember scope on that as well. And this does work, new user.sayHi, because we're using going to say hi inside new user, which is scoped inside there. And when you use class, there is inheritance for scoping, so you don't have to like add the prototype in there. So say hi will be exposed correctly, and you can use this dot name, and it'll pass it through as John. So, and I won't go into more. There's a lot more examples on that. Describe function binding. I don't remember much of this. Sorry. Let's see if we can just look this up real quick. Function binding, two approaches, okay. That's talking about losing this. This gets kind of complicated. The this.value takes on when you leave a class and you go into a, outside of that class, but you go into a different what am I trying to say here? Anyway, this is going too long. Anyway, it's going to be right here is we're going to be going over it. I hate to cut this short, but I really don't want to. As demonstrated in the chapter function binding functions JavaScript have a dynamic this. It depends on the context of the call. So if an object method is passed around and called in another context, this won't be a reference to its object anymore. For instance, this code will show undefined. Okay, so that is because this.value does not equal this same this.value because you have left the context of class. You see how class button is all self-contained here. So when you went to this.value, you went into a different context, and this is not passed. And you can fix it by changing the bracketry to include, or it's changing the syntax to equal instead of click function, you do click as a variable equals anonymous function pass, and then run alert.thisValue, and that would actually call and bring over the correct this.value in that iteration. So I went really fast on that, but that's what that's going about, talking about there. We talked about inheritance of classes already. Briefly talked about conflicts with JS with functional programming. Okay, we already talked about that. So that's that. Sorry, I went a little fast on that, but I didn't want to miss out on some of the meat and potatoes here. So one of the things it talks about in here, there's a practice. It says, go back to your library example and refactor it to use class instead of plain constructors. Don't forget to use the Git workflow you learned in the Foundations lesson to work on a new feature. You should get used to working like this. So I'm not going to go over the workflow, the Git workflow part, because that's actually quite involved. That's all this I didn't hear in the command line kung fu. You see, there's a lot of stuff. I wanted to go over it, but we just don't have time. So please review the foundations course, paper, rock, scissors, rework, and work side by side with that to do a new feature, and create a new feature and a new, I guess it'd be branch. Sorry, I couldn't remember the name. It works you through making a new branch for a new feature and then merging that. But for the video here, we're going to go over class. So this is what the, if you remember before, we had, instead of, I've already refactored this, so class object here is class book, and then it's got the constructor embedded. It's actually very simple, and I already verified this works. But remember before, I had the object constructor here. So it said, function book, and then it was, simply this dot title author pages read, and then that was the object constructor. If I pull it up in GitHub, I can probably show you what it looked like before. Let's see here. Let's see if I can see all commits. Okay. See what this does. Yeah, so here's what we had before. I had before a function book title author pages read, and then this dot title author pages read, and I added in what you just seen, class book. So we're creating a class, and then it's got a constructor embedded inside of it, and this works just fine. I verified that by testing out the app in the browser here. So if you remember this from before, we'll just do a couple examples here. I'll do no on this just to get some variety, just to show you that it didn't break, my feature didn't break. Okay, so it's doing all its console.logging and such. So we're going to toggle red status, that works great. Toggle red status, that works great. And toggle red status, works great. Remove from library, works great. And we'll do my library to see if it's syncing up correctly. We have object 0 and 1, 0 and 1, perfect. Remove 1 from the library, and now we should have my library has one array item at position 0, index 0, title 0, 0. Okay, that's good. Remove library, and now my library should be empty. Array is empty. So yeah, it still works. Reset form works. As usual, reset form, yep. So cool. That works great. All right, this went a little longer, not too bad, a little longer than I wanted to, but please rewatch for further understanding, and especially if I went over really fast on the class constructor. It's super simple, though. Basically, we're just replacing function with the word class. I use the same exact class name, so that my let book equals new book title author pages read here doesn't have to change. I didn't have to change any of that code, and then just embed the constructor inside of it. So that part's doing the exact same thing. And then it's pushing it to my library just as it did before. So that is it. So hope you enjoyed the journey today with me and come along for the ride. Please like, share, and subscribe for more content. Let me know in the comments section what you guys thought of this exercise, this little mini exercise of doing a new feature and refactoring some code and doing your Git merge and all that. And let me know what your thoughts are on JavaScript classes and whether you like them or hate them. It seems like it's a 50-50 out there in the world. So it's always good to know this stuff. This is classes are an ES6 only code base, so if you end up working for a company that is using an older code base, you probably won't see much or any class attribute or class classes defined like this, because it's only an ES6, you know, newer code base style. So you might run into more prototyping and factory functions and object literals, probably more so than class, since they're more widely supported and widely used. But you just never know. You could end up working for a startup, and they usually use the latest and greatest. So anyway, I will quit rambling on. With all that said, until next time, see ya.